Greetings, great people, or great Abyssinian people. On November 12, 2015, a Rastaman named Ras Ayavi, the local PNP government, and some white people from an American company were named High Times, who deals strictly with hydroponic plastic ganja. All three of them enter in our agreement and then produce a ganja show down on the grill named the Rastafari Roots Festival. This event, it turned the dreams of local ganja farmers in a nightmare. This is a report about the festival broadcast by IRFM on December 20, 2015 upon the Running African show between Sister Kabu and Ras Ayavi, who is one of the three main organizers of the show.
All right, joining me in the studio now, Ras Ayavi. Hey, Ivy, morning.
Yes, greetings, Kabu.
Good to have you.
Business and give thanks to the here, you know?
Yeah, I mean, you were here before when we were playing the tape. Right. We were playing the program from 2013.
Right.
But you're really just joining us physically in the studio now. And it would seem, and I think people are going to immediately think you're here to talk about choir guns, but not quite. I'm sure you'll have some response to that. But you're actually here on another mission, which is really for us to look at the what I'm calling the ganja renaissance in Jamaica in terms of the decriminalization, etc., and to ensure that there is no exclusion of the masses of Rastafari, the bulk, the people who have been farming, who have been to prison, who have been in the trenches literally for many moons at this time, well, over the many years, and then now when we have a situation where there is a loosening, have a situation where there is a loosening of the chains, so to speak, then we're not quite sure where we're going and how we're getting there. And this is why we've asked you to come in to help us to understand your own perspective on this, but also to help us to understand what you see as the best way forward, having been involved in this at such a level. But before we do that, So the final thing is to say that your views on this, Rastafari should now come together.
Exactly. Right. And there are many reasons, Kabu, why I and I need to come together. Right?
Yes.
And depending from the coral garden and the atrocities, the present situation that I and I face within this, where this marijuana industry is concerned.
Yes.
Looking at it from a financial point of view, is that for anybody to come and seriously benefit financially from out of this industry, they have to be in the position where they can establish type of facilities that will match the criteria of whatever
of the global standards.
Exactly.
And the global standards, though, and I want your response to this, is really a genetically modified standard. That's a global standard that's coming out of Codex. And we have to go there, Ivy. So let us talk about those global standards.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, at the same time, those global standards in terms of, from a medicinal point of view, right? We have labs out here now that can and are internationally accredited.
Mm-hmm.
So these labs supposed to allow farmers to bring in seeds and to bring in products so that they can be tested legally to find out what it is that we have here.
And what is that to bring from their own farms?
Right.
Right. And because these labs are based where?
All over Jamaica, okay. Because legally at the moment, Kabu, I mean, we read at a day that BSG will be importing seeds.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, why is it that some interim period, and I've said this to individual within the government of Jamaica, why is it that some interim period or a period is not given that people all over Jamaica can bring their seeds and bring their products to BSJ, to UA, to UTEC, so that it can be tested, so that we know what it is that we have here, whether we match that CDD standard that is required or that is regarded as medicinal marijuana, or what it is that we have.
Mm-hmm.
Because in the US, I mean, most of the herb grown are grown under light. Mm-hmm. And scientists will tell you there's nothing that is grown under light that can match that which is grown under in natural condition under good sunlight and so on.
So what is it then that is causing the state to be looking to importing seeds as opposed to looking at what farmers here in Jamaica are producing?
And this is where our voice needs to be heard again, Kabu, because I and I did tests. We there was a company here from the US called Steepil, and I and I carried out tests in Senesbet, in Hanover, in Westmoreland, and found marijuana with high CBD, just like how we found marijuana with high THC. So I and I know that there, what is regarded as medical marijuana, where CBD content is concerned, we have it here in Jamaica. It's just
why are we being told then that we do not have it? Because that is the school of thought.
Because in the first place, Kabu, most of these people who are in administrative position, most of these agencies that are set up by government don't know anything about the herb industry. And that's the reality of it.
But the danger in that is that Rastafari generally, ganja farmers, local ganja farmers who have suffered through the years just to farm ganja, are now being squeezed out of this entire process. I want to say something to you, IRV. I was at the Cannabis Cup event in Westmoreland, and that was my main concern. That was my main concern after doing interviews, after observing, after attending seminars, quietly attending seminars and just observing. My main concern was the extent to which the local and the small ganja farmer will be squeezed out of this process. Your own thoughts on this?
All right, to be honest, there were negative reactions. When I and I proposed certain things, remember last year, I and I set up the first Ganja Farmers Association. Mm-hmm. Because what I and I was saying then, I and I still saying now, that mm-hmm. if I and I didn't do that, mm-hmm. that the grassroots farmers and the Rastafari community mm-hmm. would be pushed out of the business. So that's why we settled. But a lot of Rastafari brethren and sisters didn't see the importance of that, Kabu. Right?
So of what? Of farming organizations?
Of farming organization and making their voices be heard. And that people can know about them. When I and I decided to do this cup, I and I sent individuals, we connected all the farmers association that I and I knew about, right, in St. James.
No, but I don't mean those who were in attendance, because people could not come for many.
No.
I'm talking about
just listen out, right? Yes. So what I and I do, I and I connected these individuals, and I sent individuals legally to pick up the entries coming from all over, St. Mary, St. Thomas, St. and all over. So if it was a matter that I and I had known about any individual who wanted to enter, because it was there, and I
said, no, but I mean, you're missing the point. I mean, I'm not talking about the cannabis cup itself. I am talking about what the discourse that I heard in the different seminars that I attended, and also the way the those who came in from overseas, the big money, so to speak, was in the grill on the weekend.
Right.
And the way that things were done, the warning bell to me is that this is not about, not the cannabis cup event, but the way what is happening with ganja in Jamaica. It is not about the small farmer. It is not about, not just Rasta, but it's not about this local small ganja farmer who's been doing this for many, many moons. It seems to me as if it is geared more at big money, including big pharma.
And I totally 100% agree with you, Kabu, and that's why I'm here this morning.
Talk to us.
That's the same concern I have. Right? Because that's why I say the facilities that will be needed that to match up to the criteria of, for example, what will be recommended, the average grassroots individual cannot afford that. Right? And the financial institution legally will not be allowed to finance these grassroots farmers. So they will now have to look for overseas supporters, which will be difficult to get because these traditional grassroots farmers are not known. For example, like how some big companies here, I mean, when you look at a Ganja, I mean, company with two former prime minister on it, what position
are, and a former governor general,
right? What position is the grassroots farmers in to compete economically or political influence with these type of people? So I am 100% agree, and therefore I am he's still here to call upon grassroots farmers, upon the Rastafari community, to recognize how important it is to come together. Because if I and I don't come together with I and I people, I and I, every one of I and I classified as traditional Ganja farmers, as poor people, will be pushed out of this, because the big investors will be coming in with their millions, and they will be partnering with individuals out here who, as a matter of fact, was never involved in marijuana. It's just because, yes, it is now being legalized and there's an industrial money to be made while they're coming aboard. So it is for us to realize what is happening, and if we don't organize seriously, put ourselves in a position where we demand and command and the help decide where the industry go, we'll be pushed out of it.
Yes, and you see, the little piecemeal things like handing off a license and making a big deal of it. And Tony, I'm a virgin, I'm innocent, I'm not United, I know, but it is what it is. And Africa, I know them not necessarily United, because we heard what Tony Weber said. You know, he said, listen, we've been doing this. You know, we've been doing this. And it's just a piece of paper, I'm arguing now, but we've been doing this. So that to make a big splash of that and to make that be your front page thing of, you know, here's another event that has been given license to so people can come there, come smoke ganja free. If that is that, it's a smoke screen. It's a smoke screen, Ivy.
It cannot stop at having an event, Kabu, when the big industry,
yes,
when the big industry is being controlled by foreign investors and rich people here who used to fight against I and I and Herb. It cannot be like that. I and I want to be a part of that marketing force, marketing power, to make money out of in this industry, not to give them permission to smoke a spliff or to grow 5 root of herb, when the big money is still being made by foreign investors and these same people who have always been in control of the economy and the politics of Jamaica.
And that was always a danger when they began to debate the decriminalization. It was always a danger. It was a death knell that I sounded in this space, because I actually honestly saw this coming, that it's a piecemeal, it's a smoke screen where you decriminalize and you keep the masses.
As if they are satisfied, and yeah, you must be happy with
yeah,
that.
Yeah, and you must be happy with that.
Right.
Whereas there is a whole industry that's coming out of this that include two former prime ministers, former governor general, multi-million-dollar corporations from Canada and other places that are partnering with multi-million-dollar corporations here in Jamaica.
Right.
And then what? What happens to...
And then it become a next tourist industry, Kabu, like how it started in Negril, where poor people open their doors to one and two tourists. And that is how tourism started. Now you have big multinational, big hotels now, where what is happening? What has happened to the people who started it? They are no longer recognized. They are pushed out. So it's the same thing now. In other words, our people... A next sugarcane industry will be created, where our people are being used to plant and to do the hard work, but the big manufacturers are really the ones who really make the serious money. So
what to do?
The situation is that we are the people, and this is where the education of our people, where the industry is concerned, is important, because they have to know what is happening, and a lot of them do know what is happening. But they have to put politics, partisan politics, one side. They have to put religious thing one side, and know that this is something that can serve the interests of our grassroots people development, and as such organize themselves. The Rastafari community also have a serious responsibility in that we are not just satisfied with, yes, having sacramental rights where we can plant some herb and we can sell.
But that is a trick.
Right.
That is a trick in the decriminalization, you know.
So that's what I'm saying. We have to focus on the big industry, Kabu, the big pie, right? Because otherwise, These people who control money in Jamaica, they are the ones who control the politics, they are the ones who control the destiny of the people. And I am saying, this is the last straw or the last stranglehold of colonialism upon our people. Economics.
I saw people, there were some, you might not use some of the terms, you might not like some of the terms I'm going to use now, IRB. It is no reflection on you, it is what I witnessed. But I saw secret meetings. When I went to the Cannabis Cup, there were secret meetings happening. And I'm telling you about these secret meetings. The big multi-million dollar corporation people who were representing big pharma, and when we say pharma, we mean pharmaceuticals and farmer, F-A-R-M-E-R, the two of them. Big multinational corporations, multi-million dollar corporation representatives were there at the Cannabis Cup, but not at the venue. They just came into Westmoreland, capitalized on what was happening there, and had secret meetings in hotels outside of the venue. And at these secret meetings, they outlined some of their business plans. Rasta not included in a them. I don't even know if any Rasta was in any of them secret meetings, or maybe not. But ordinary local Jamaicans not included in those talks. People just came this was a central point,
right,
where ganja people, people with multi-million dollar corporations were going to meet for a weekend. So let us come in. And they came from all over the world, and they had their secret meetings at five-star hotels. These are people talking only English with received pronunciation.
Right. Well, Kabu, I went and addressed the Friday. I went and I addressed one of those sessions. And exactly what I'm saying to you now is what I said to that gathering. Because anywhere I go, I am who I am and I talk freely. Nobody do more to me. The said thing I'm saying to you, that we're not going to sit by and watch this industry being taken over by foreign investors and by people here in Jamaica who were responsible for our persecution, is what I've been saying from day one. And that is what I've said to them. It came out in, that was the Friday, it came out in the Monday Observer. And I call also on the government to align itself with countries who have similar views in terms of decriminalizing and legalizing, because America seemed to have a big stick over our head saying, you can do what I say, but never do what I do, because look at what America is doing. So in reality, I know of those meetings, and I went there.
I don't think you went to all of them in the IRB.
No.
I don't even think you knew about all of them either.
Did you know about
the one up at Rick's Cafe?
No.
Okay,
no,
because you went to the one at the other hotel.
Right.
There were secret meetings all across Negril. Right. And granted, you were one of the chief organizers of the event there.
Of the event.
And not knowing that people had come in to capitalize in the way they did. So that the private sector in Jamaica, along with their multinational corporation partners, were hosting secret meetings across Negril at the time of a Cannabis Cup. And this, all of that also was a smoke screen. No, the question is what to do. I see also that there is a barrier to entry for groups that want to start and to cannabis organizations.
Right.
That there are a lot of obstacles placed in their way at many different levels. I am talking from experience. So this to me then is an interesting thing. Why is it so difficult?
Honestly speaking, Kabu, I don't think it's difficult, right?
IRV, some people are having it really difficult.
All right, let me.
And we can open the phone lines and ask people
what their
experiences have been.
Because
getting their organizations registered. What is the situation with the word ganja? Somebody has registered the word ganja?
No. What is the situation, and that is what we have with the government at the moment? When I and I wanted to register Westmoreland Hemp and Ganja Farmers Association, we couldn't register anything with ganja, and we couldn't register anything with hemp.
You know that me I talk about?
Right.
That's what we're calling barrier to entry, you know?
Yeah.
So why couldn't you?
What? Because according to them, anything having to do with ganja is illegal. Right, and I had to register a next name, right, but still go along with Westmoreland Hemp and Ganja Farmers Association.
But somebody have that name there. There's an organization that have ganja in them name.
It is not registered here.
Where it register?
It is registered in Canada.
Which one is that?
From what I know, Rasta Ganja.
Not Rasta Ganja. Right. What the Paul Burke organization name? Is it a Ganja something?
No, Jamaica Growers and Producers Association.
Okay. So you have to register the name overseas before you can use it here, sir? And you can't use it here, same if you register it overseas?
No, you can use the name, but you cannot register the name here. It is not. And these are things that we've been discussing with different administrators, because this is stupidness. You understand? If you look at the countries that... England and all these places who help, and America help establish and family laws for control, and I don't hear. You can register things with ganja. You can register companies. You can register products, right? You can register hemp wine. Hemp beer used to come from England, come to Jamaica, right? Hemp is a legal thing. You have the hemp seeds all over the world, and these things, yet it cannot be registered here in Jamaica. So these are barriers that need to be broken down.
And we see, right? A lot of these products now in the supermarkets. I see Rasta Black sent me the other day a package that he saw in one of the supermarkets of ganja product in Jamaican supermarket.
And it need a lot of voices, Kabu. It need a lot of voices coming in. It need a lot of people coming in, sitting down, standing up, reasoning, putting on paper what is going on, what need to be done. So, for example, I am a part of the CLA board. I don't speak for the CLA board.
I did not introduce you as such.
Right. But I know that things need to be sent to the CLA board. Things need to be sent to the government, both to especially industry and ministry, because most of these people who are now involved in the administration of the marijuana industry, Kabu, don't know about marijuana. They are learning on the job. They are, listening to consultants coming from the US and most of these places. Who, why not open the door and sit with your own people who have been involved in the industry over a period
of time? But what is preventing that? That is the question. Is this another political partisan gimmick where people are being put, are shuffled into position, just waiting for the floodgate to open? What is preventing the state, the government, from tapping into that institutional knowledge, that tacit knowledge that Jamaican ganja farmers have?
That one, the first thing government is going to say to anybody, they don't have the funds to do this and they don't have the funds to do that. Right? Because right now there should be field officers going out into the communities, sitting down, talking with ganja farmers, saying to them, helping them to organize, saying to them what they can do or what they need to do in order to attract investors and so on.
And in order to not to be left behind.
Exactly.
Because there's an imminent danger that you're just going to wake up and wonder, you know, what happened?
Exactly.
How come? I want to take some calls, Ivy, because I just feel that there are people who want to ask questions.
Yes, I'd be grateful.
In the last 10 minutes that we have, 974-5079-5051-5043 and 1-888-991-4152. We take your calls right after this. 974-5079-5051-5043 and 1-888-991-4152 are the numbers to call. We know we've got quite a few calls holding there already. IAV with just a little time, so I'm going to ask you, once you come on the line, just to make it very brief so that we can get to another call. Hello, good morning, Hotep.
Hi, good morning. Yes. Uncle Jasaneb.
Uncle Jasaneb.
I'm just calling in on the ganja issue.
Yes.
As quickly as possible. I would just like to say that the Rastafari community,
mm-hmm,
should have approached the ganja issue in a collective manner, as a more indigenous group of people that are a collective group on their own.
Mm-hmm.
The approach to it should not have been individual organizations all over and so forth. To me, I think that as Rasta, and as a person who is Rastafari, that the Nyabingi and the other Rasta organizations should have been brought together to deal with the government.
All right, we're gonna have Iyah respond to that. Iyah, your response to that?
Yeah, well, that was done, Kabu, and anybody who follow in the Rastafari history know, for example, that school of vision, the whole approach to the herb issue was done collectively, saying that the Nyabinga House, School of Vision, 12 Tribe was involved, Rasta Village, all of these different mansions came together. I was asked to represent these mansion houses and mansions on the CLA board. That's why I am on the CLA board. So that was there. But again, I am saying that you have individuals and you have Rastafari groups who never did envisage certain things. And so they are now reacting. I and I had to be proactive because I and I saw down the road what would happen and tried to make sure so that it didn't happen, you know.
My brother, I have to take another one quickly. Give you 30 seconds.
Yes, well, again, we say these things, but we don't see it as a reality because we don't see that collective push in the Rastafari towards the ganja. Don't even know what's happening in the ganja field. They don't know nothing about anything about this ganja. I'm just trying to be as quick as possible, and I'm saying that there needed to be a different approach completely. And I spoke about these big corporations coming in to take over the ganja.
I do have to go, my brother. Thank you so much. We're going to continue the conversation. Yes, give thanks. All right. It's a conversation that, of course, we're going to have to continue, IV. We're taking another call. Yeah, go ahead, IV.
And that is David from Hanover. I know him very well, and he knows what is going on. You understand? We have worked together with Hanover Virgin and assisting them and tried to get that. He knows with that.
All right, let's take another one. Hotem?
Good morning.
Hi, good morning. Quickly, we have just a few seconds. Yes.
I'm calling on the behalf of Grand Bahia Principal.
Yes.
They employed us for 3 weeks. We signed a contract for 3 months and they terminate our service in 3 weeks without a cost.
All right, so you work in the hotel, you're employed, you sign a contract for 3 months.
3 months.
And they terminated you in 3 weeks?
3 weeks.
Is there a union at that hotel?
We were employed by UHY.
What is UHY?
It's an agency, UHY Darden.
And what is your agency saying?
They just called me when I was on my day off on Friday and told me that my service is
all right. What I'm going to have to do is take this up at another level. So I'm going to ask you to call back, ask Shamara Preston, and give her your number. All right?
Okay.
In the meantime, you can also call the Ministry of Labor.
Okay.
All right? Okay. All right. Thanks for calling. It is happening to our people all across Jamaica.
All over.
So can we take one, Bigay? I got 3 minutes, Bigay. I have 3 minutes on the clock. All right, it seems we have to wrap. Go ahead.
Yeah, in the meantime, Cabo just wanted to be in and sisting them in Western Jamaica that we're having a reasoning at Pit 4, you know, Nyabinga Center today. And we're looking forward
to Nyabinga Center. Hold on, quickly. Call her, go ahead. Quickly, quick.
Yes, hello. I have about 4 questions to her.
Quickly.
One of the questions is that, why is now the plant in Ganja in university? And I would like to know, if it's all the students planting 5 trees, or how many trees they are planting?
And yes.
And the other question is that, why is that they want to involve the bigger one who used to fight against it, want to involve in it now, and want us to get ID to plant it? And the answer for it is that, I will answer it, it is not going to work.
All right, thank you so much.
And yes, more thing now.
Yes.
Last thing, I won't keep up. If they don't listen to what Rastafari is saying, is when things happen, they're going to listen. And I believe so, because
we're out of time.
And as Andrea, I tell you this morning, ancestors is with you. They are all with you.
Give thanks. All right. Okay, so you hear those questions?
Yes. In the first place, she was going to answer it, you know, because them just want to keep certain economic control over the marijuana industry.
Well, now that we know that,
right.
Two things are happening. You're mentioning something that's happening today.
Right. The reasoning is taking place at the Pitfor Naya Dingy Center, and that I and I will be there on the 7th of January celebrating Ethiopian nativity, you know.
What time today?
1 o'clock. We start right. at 1 o'clock.
And then on the 26th, the Rastafari friends in Akompong, and I suppose some of these questions will be raising because we're right. talking about economic development.
Right.
Then I'm sure that the issue of ganja licensing, legalization, and do right. all of it
on the 26th.
On the 26th, December, Boxing Day,
right.
in Akompong,
right.
middle ground in Akompong.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned because I didn't know about that. You know?
You didn't know about it. We no. interviewed Rasta Black this morning.
Right.
So it's happening in middle ground in Akompong on the 26th, the economic Rastafari
iFriends.
So
I really want to give thanks to those who supported Rastafari Roots Fest. We know it wasn't without flaws, it had its hiccup, but if I were to come together and see how we can make it into a better event, you know.
And thank you for coming in.
Yeah, give
this
thanks.
Is always saying goodbye Rastafari. For today. What good? Telemado and Howdy, we're making way now for the big inside of a Sunday. Sunshine, until next week, we'll see you. My broadcast assistant was Shamara Preston. Thanks to everybody who participated. Thanks to you on the social media and on the 107s. Thank you so much. See you next week.
You hear the madness, you see the short-sightedness, you hear the level of trust this Rastamania place in the white people in from high times and this PNP government. Poor thing never knows how so it in ago. You see what the local Rasta them who helped set up the show here, you see what the market left out of it. The Rastaman who call, him know where I say. Him say, I just Rasta and Rasta should have put her on a show like this. And as him gone, I have E1 for discredit him, even though all throughout the show, him a call for unity amongst I and I. Well, I never think about that before him join forces with the two enemies of Rastafari. Now, after listening to all of that, come listen to this call from the cutting edge on Irie FM on November 4th, about 2 weeks Before the show, don't go on the grill. Listen.
Yeah, what's about white people this year?
Yeah, me I say after we have so much problem with white people this year, IAVI are bringing some white people from high times.
IAVI are bringing the white people. What do you mean IAVI are bringing the white people? I mean, I understand that.
Well, high times, big ganja dance now keep down there this month with high times.
Oh, sure. The man sound like the man a fight getting something, so.
What me a talk about is, nobody not talk for high times is some white people.
Then, you never hear we say that a while ago? You never hear we say that?
No, me never hear only talk for high times is some white people.
Me ask, if you never hear, you the interview a while ago?
Yes, me, I listen to the interview.
You never hear me mention, say nobody no care what they want, say pull up a white people like dead. You never hear me talk about that?
Yes, pull up a white people like dead.
Yeah.
Like white people that Jamaica, all
no,
white.
No, function me talk about, function.
Yeah, white people that full function all the while, white people that full function. Yeah. But who knows the high times, there's some high Japanic ganja people from foreign. Nobody not say that.
Nobody don't know that. Nobody knows that some white people run high times.
I saw white people run high times. So
we are there. Who did feel say that some black people run high times?
No, what are people want to feel say
no,
white
everybody, we are there. We are there, man. Listen to me now. We can't say the word for fighting. You know what I say now? You see that magazine they bought years, and everybody knows that some white people run that magazine. There. Everybody. Them keep the function of Amsterdam already. And for years, them keep it at Amsterdam. Everybody knows you are white people. Some of you know what I say.
So, am I bringing some white people to teach me about ganja and Rasta?
Brethren, you sound like you have fight the brethren and the brethren. Oh, you mean yeah, people? That, you see, am I bringing white people? Hold on, hold on. Am I bringing white people teach about Rasta? You never hear the man.
Ganja. Ganja.
Wait there, you didn't hear the interview a while ago with me and the brethren attack?
Me hear the interview with you and him.
Me and who?
Iyah.
Well, me and Iyah talk.
No, what the yarning talk, man? When after I think him come from the Paul Bogle.
So let me ask you a question.
March.
You hear say some white people have come talk about Rasta?
Me not hear that.
You never hear the brethren say them had separate the Rastafari village.
Separate what? Separate what?
All right.
Only bring some white people to come deal with Rasta and Ganja, especially in this time when all
you hear say white
that's
people why, come here come talk about Rasta.
They call them Columbus and Bagawaya Wadia. That is why the conversation. That's why they shift the conversation because the brethren never know say all you in I dance.
Me not the what?
The brother never know say all you in I dance. You in I program.
Yeah. So
Then you know, only little.
We do a live broadcast from down there.
And then only just carry the white people and associate with the white people and want the people get comfortable with the white people start on a deal it.
Are we there? Cost me too.
You want to
wait? Me ask you. Cost me too.
Me include you in the program you talk about so many things. Mm. You play so much tape and talk about so many things. And then you introduce this brother now. Like I said, them are some comfortable companion that we must get accustomed to. In the meantime, the people and brother, this come down and come tell we say, some GLN one give we. And from the next I know, we have some Rasta. I bring in white people to go and deal with Ganja and Rasta. Them think they are folly, Rasta. Them think they are folly.
So what are you going to do about it?
Well, this is what I do about it.
You talk on the program?
Yeah.
Okay.
Let me just talk about it, Rasta.
Are you saying you want to talk about it or no? I got to stop the program.
Well, when I talk about these people, I don't know the high times are some white people.
But everybody knows the high times are white people, but everybody who knows the high times are white people.
Everybody don't know.
Okay, so you
make it look like everybody know. Maybe you know, but everybody don't know. Because when we listen to the conversation between you and Iyah, you know, when we listen to it, you know, it told me this a dance on the facts as high times are some white people. As some white people who not associate with after we go on and talk all manner of things. Hey, I wanna really deal with it. No, because you can't put on this thing about the in this Rasta man the way in our neighborhood. No more than Rasta people that they both in our world who can put on this show that we don't know. We have to change some white people, all the while we need some white people to back it up. If we can't set the example. If you can't set the example, put on a Rasta show and a Ganja show without white people who are dealing with hydroponic Ganja. Feel as 40 a year. Start a loaf on a loaf out this thing. Jano.
All right, you done?
Yes.
All right, sir. Give thanks. Wow. Wow. Okay, so. The man say me a bring in me and why me not anyway, make it run. Me want to play about this tune here by I mean just I keep I say Damian, but it's really Kimani Mali. This is
yeah,
the cutting edge. You know, understand something where I go on, you know. I mean, the virgin are getting me involved in everything I feel, but I understand this where I go on, you know. You have a group of man who, because you never get the first go with the high times people, them, and Iyah connect with them. It's almost like a jealous thing I go on. Yeah, it look like it's that I go on, yes? It look like you have some man. And I'm going to Rasta man too, who is on the other side of Iyah. It's like a friction of Guan. I don't know how I get involved with that still, but it's like a friction of Guan that I should have get piece of this, and I should have get part of that. And because I now get part of it, I am going to try find all the things them to discredit where I have here though in a Negril. I feel that I go on. Discredit that because I am not a part of it. Because I didn't want to be a part of it and I never get to go in part of it. So I have to discredit it every way possible. It's a terrible thing, you know. Yeah, man, you talk about ego. You talk about ego and grudgeful and bad mind. You just hear it a while ago. Yes. Shine one thing I know for sure. That's the far right guy that's the taker. But you know what I'm saying? Why? I tell you, that program is something else, though. For really do them program, you know, you have to. You have to make sure say your blood pressure low run go. We are telling you man, for the program man, you have to call the most diverse calling and talking and you man have put me in some bracket and all that. Me never know so be in a bracket at you know. Mm. Me never know. The man say Uno. Who the bring white people have to come teach? Teach you about Rasta and Ganja. And some really good. I don't know if you call them, brother. And some dirty minded people them there. I mean, some people, eh? You call dirty mind, and some dirty mind, that, you know.
Corrupt.
If you really come, really, a loop of Rasta. What I mean, really, anyway, we don't have pressure the kids. So you're a program right already, so start your program because we don't have no more music we can play now. Let's not complete it till you're ready. I'm going to put some advertisement there.
Real thing.
No, when we listen to Sister Kabu and Iyah, we see some motor there way out of line. In passing place, in how him respond to this call. This call did right. You can't trust white people. We must never trust them. Ganja is now presented by certain groups as a product. Them see it like banana now, to be bought and sold. And that is a business. A ganja business that is now lawful. The problem is, Rasta never used to see ganja as a business. It was a glorious, sacramental plant directly from the Creator that was freely exchanged and was used to attain a higher level of consciousness with life, with the planet. This plant was made illegal by white people. Now, years later, the same white people, they are going to legalize this plant and convert it in our business. That means money. Money we everybody need. So because Iyah wants some of this money, him agree to treat ganja as a business where Rasta should have get involved in. Even if it could have got so, him choose the wrong people them to work with. Him believes that Rastafari should have make some money from ganja today, only because Rasta was persecuted for years and years for possession of this herb. Iyah should also know, say, Nuff Barlead was also persecuted and enough of them spent years in a prison for the same possession of ganja. Iyah must know, say, the persecution of Rasta is not about possessing ganja. It was about them teaching about our African heritage and about repatriation. It was about their refusal to respect and join the workforce of the slave master, choosing instead to sell things to earn a living. And because Rasta was independent, self-employed, and referred to the king and queen of England as oppressors, it was that mindset that the slave master never wanted to spread. It never had nothing to do with ganja. It was strictly by coincidence that them realized, say, most Rasta who them arrest, them have ganja in them possession. And as such, they make the link now for demonize ganja and arrest even more Rasta. So any problem with Rasta have for possessing ganja when ganja was illegal is of no consequence to the people them who want to make money out of it today. Then the business with that. That is two different story. Business is business. Rasta is Rasta. And the law is the law. we can't see them thing there. As such, the revolutionary function of Rastafari must not be dragged into the financial delinquencies of certain individuals because they were abused. We cannot misuse a revolutionary organization like Rastafari for personal financial gain. It not go work. First, them try to turn Rasta into a religious organization, and that never work. Now them try to turn it into a Ganja organization, that not go work either. The enemies of Rastafari, they must laugh now. They must laugh at those Rasta who joined for them bandwagon, knowing full well, say, you have other Rasta out there who is very unhappy. Them very unhappy with them, the Rasta there, who endorse them and sanction them presence in Jamaica. Now, to get a deeper understanding of things leading up to the event in Negril, the event itself, and things after the event, you need to look on a video name, The Rasta Deception Somewhat. The video name, The Rasta Deception Somewhat. It clear up everything. Ashe.